expect you all read about the group of Lifford boys and their bus trip to Spain. Tonight we relive some of their experiences on that memorable journey, which we at the Herald came to know as the epic voyage of Harry Pillock.
Began in the autumn of 1967 at the Fair's Hut just outside Lifford. We at the Herald had been impressed by the initiative of the Lifford Young Conservatives in building a full-size aeroplane as their Lifford Carnival entry, and a story of the march they made, collecting for charity, as they towed the Discord 34 miles from Lifford to Pitchfield, was one of the outstanding features of our mid-November issue. Out of their endeavours sprang the seeds of an idea which was to bring us our biggest story in 1968. But let us hear in their own words how the group that came to be known as Harry Pillock faced and overcame all the difficulties and setbacks which lay between them and the successful achievement of their ambitious goal.
It was on our way back from Titchfield that the idea first came to us. To buy an old double-decker bus, convert it to a mobile home, and take it to Europe on holiday. The first problem was to buy a bus, and the second, where to keep it. Fortunately, one of the group, Andrew Luff, owned a farm in Lipok, and so we set to work making a hard standing area for the bus on the corner of one of his fields. There were to be 9 owners of the bus: John Carver, Bob Hall, Richard Hayes, Alan and Clive Hughes, Richard King, Andrew Luff, Peter Windebank, and John Wilson. We all paid a £10 deposit, and the rest of the £45 would be paid in monthly instalments. This would cover not only buying the bus, but the cost of our holiday as well. We decided that there would be room for 12 people on holiday, and as Andrew Luff's farm work prevented him from going, there were spaces for 4 more, and these were filled by Adrian Bird, Roland Hutchings, Tim Palmer, and Wally Walsh. But to use it for trips at home as well. The name Harry Pillock was adopted from the outset, as they were the words most used during the building of Discord Aeroplane. Andrew Luff and I found it rather difficult explaining to the bank we wanted to open a joint account in the name of Harry Pillock, but they allowed us to in the end. We then set about finding a bus, and bought a 20-year-old Leyland from Portsmouth Corporation. It was a PD1 model with a 7.4-litre engine, and had covered over 500,000 miles in service. It had recently been fitted with a new engine, and although the inside was dirty and grimy, it suited our purpose ideally. Our plan was to completely rebuild the inside of the bus, with bunks, sink unit, tables and seats, a cooker, storage space for food, drink and luggage, carpets on the floors, and to make the bus as comfortable as possible. And so, in March 1968, with the bus MOT tested, taxed and insured, parked on its new bay at Midlands Farm, we started on the conversion work that was to take us 4 months to complete. Our first job in converting the bus was to strip down all the paintwork, to sand it right down, almost to the bare metal, and then we would put a couple of coats of undercoat on, and then a top coat. The original colours inside the bus were a rather nasty dark brown, and we changed this upstairs to a nice light grey, and downstairs to a deep blue. One of the master painters on the bus was Clive Hughes, and this is his comment.
The glistening paintwork is due almost entirely to the expert work of Clive Hughes. Begin.
All the electrical work on the bus, Alan, you know, it blew up after we left.
Nobody trusts my wiring.
For the seating both downstairs and upstairs, we were able to utilise some of the original seats from the bus. Across the front, facing backwards downstairs, was the back seat from an old coach we found in a scrapyard near Chichester. It was a lucky coincidence that the material used to make this seat was the same as the material of the seats we already had for the bus, and it fitted in very nicely into the pattern. We fitted a claxton onto the front of the bus, and this was operated by the driver, who pulled a large lavatory chain which hangs down inside the cab. A lot of the work carried out on the bus was done not by those people who were going on the holiday, but by their friends, who very kindly came down and helped them out. All the window frames and ceiling joints were faced with wooden battens which had been on the bus for over 20 years and were covered with 20 years worth of varnish, and this had to be scraped off, and the whole of the wood was sanded down to a light finish and then covered with two coats of clear polyurethane, and this made a rather nice attractive lining to our brilliant paintwork. We removed all the seats on the upper deck apart from eight at the front, which were left to form the navigation area. Behind the navigation area were spaces for suitcases and luggage racks, and behind them were bunks. On one side there were bunks for six people in two tiers of three, and on the opposite side to that were bunks for three people in one tier of three, next to the luggage rack. The whole of the front area of the bus, separating the navigation department from the sleeping area, was wood-panelled by Peter Winderbank, who, having seen the film, made this comment.
For a number one driver, his hand signals are wonderful.
Peter Winderbank was responsible for quite a lot of the work upstairs.
The basic framing of the bunks was done with prepared timbers of two by two section and 2x1 section. And the actual base units were Crosby standard doors, reject doors, which can be bought from Crosby, 7 and 6 per lorry load.
Yes.
Each.
That don't make sense.
Not only did we redecorate the bus inside, but we also redecorated the driver's cabin. There's Adrian cleaning the driver's door off. We painted it a light blue. It was, of course, the original dirty brown colour of Portsmouth Corporation. We repainted all the brown leather on the seats a deep blue colour, made it stand out and shine and look almost like new. As well as doing painting work inside the bus, Clive Hughes also did a lot of touching up outside, and here he is, repainting one of the rear mudguards. We were very fortunate in that Doug Daly and Alan Hughes, who are both expert mechanics, were able to examine the bus mechanically and give it a complete service and oil change. The bus was in excellent mechanical condition and had been used very well by the corporate. It had a new back axle, it was found, as well as having a reasonably modern engine. All the oil and fuel filters were changed, the oils were renewed, and the bus was made completely safe and ready. All the springs were checked, and it was found that the bus was in A1 working condition. And here we are, the bus fully cleated after 5 months of work. At the back we have the aluminium sink unit with a tap which is fed from the tanks upstairs. Opposite to that we have the built-in radiogram and record player with the speaker built into the side of the wall cabinet. Next to that the cocktail cabinet, and then the Calagas cooker with 3 burners and a grill. Opposite to that we have the plate rack which carries our cups, saucers and beer mugs. Upstairs, we have the 9 bunks, the luggage area. Towards the front, we have the navigation cockpit with the table, the intercom to the driver, the map reading light, the electric fan, a loudspeaker extension from the radio downstairs, and now the bus, completely equipped, is ready for its first journey. And so in June 1968, 5 months after the work was started, Pillock was ready for the first of many trips with the Lifook Young Conservatives to the George at East Meon, weekends down to Charmouth and the South Coast, and, of course, a trip to the House of Commons to see Edward Heath before Harry Pillock started on its massive journey to Spain.